You had an exclusive interview with Michael Jackson the evening before the trial. In your personal opinion, what was his state of mind the evening before the trial, during the trial, and after the trial, and do you think he was innocent?
In 2005, when that case was being brought to trial in San Bernardino, California, it was being brought to trial with the backdrop of the 1993 settlement of the case, which kind of tainted Michael and branded him a pedophile, and that image was cemented by his later interviews with Martin Bashir, principally, Ed Bradley, not as damaging, but also a lot about sleeping with boys and that. And then Oprah had come before, so her interview was kind of the last. That was the last good Michael Jackson interview. Then you had the two bombshell interviews, and then you had Michael being branded a pedophile. Full stop. As the case was being, remember, the charges were brought in 2003, 2004, delay, delay, delay. But what was clear to me as an attorney was a couple of red flags. Number one, it was the same lawyer representing the victim's family as represented the family in 1993 that had gotten the huge settlement from Michael. Moreover, it was the same psychologist interviewing the victim, the child victim, as had testified very damningly in 1993. Both of them, in the subsequent years, had, in my opinion, developed the reputation of, you know, targeting victims or targeting defendants that they thought would settle before trial. In this case, the criminal case overrode the civil case, but a conviction would have resulted in a civil trial that would have resulted in a bountiful settlement for this settlement oriented team. So that's what raised my suspicion. Then I started thinking also about the victim himself. The victim was handicapped. The victim was very, very frail. The victim was a bit older and bigger than the children who typically were targeted allegedly by Michael. Michael had, if indeed he had this proclivity, an endless supply of able-bodied blonde boys, surfer kids running around. I mean, he could have chosen, if he were so inclined, he could have picked any one of these kids if he wanted. So I started saying to myself, what is the proof that the San Bernardino district attorney really has? And I started looking at the proof, and there was no proof other than the testimony of the child and the mother. Remember, there were allegations about her being a welfare cheat and applied for other government programs to which she was not eligible. So the victims were shaky. I didn't believe the fact pattern as alleged by the district attorney. The district attorney hated Michael Jackson, hated the Neverland Ranch in San Bernardino, was extremely ambitious politically in my view. I was so confident after my own investigation that Michael would be acquitted of the charges, although virtually every other commentator said he would be convicted, I bet my mustache. I said, if he's convicted, I'll shave this mustache, which has not been shaven since 1968, 7 years before my wife was born. Another P.S. Anyway, over the course of this investigation of my own, not on camera, I began a dialogue with Michael Jackson. So I started talking to Michael and became ultimately, I guess you would say, a confidant. He would call me. He would sometimes go, he would let my phone conversations be, our phone conversations be recorded. He, gave me access that others didn't. And finally, ultimately invited me to his mother's home in the valley in Encino to do the television interview. You asked me how he was before the trial. He was on the good side, he was a very typical, normal seeming, except for the packaging. I mean, obviously, there's, you know, Michael, you know, had a very unusual personal style, and all the rest of it. And the packaging was, you know, unusual. But the way he was with his children was absolutely normal. I'm the father of five. And like me, Michael often refereed Nickelodeon or Disney Channel, Captain Crunch or Cheerios. I saw him, without a nanny, without a PR person. It was just me and Michael and the three children. The youngest was about a year old at the time. He would change the diapers. He would feed the children. He would be the person, the primary caregiver, and I could not fault him one bit. He was absolutely as competent as any single dad I have seen, and as normal. That's the good news. The bad news is, as the trial got closer and closer, he became more paranoid, more frightened. I mean, it is a frightening prospect. When every time you turn on the television, think about it, someone is saying you're going to go to jail for 20 or 30 years and good riddance, and he's sick and he's a pervert and all the rest of it. I would often be with him and watch with my own eyes when he would retreat into a fetal position. He would crunch himself up in the corner of a couch. He would be in a room. This is not when the children were around, obviously. He would be in a room where the blinds were drawn and no sunlight was coming in. And he would cover his ears in the way children sometimes do when they don't want to hear a parent tell them they can do it or can't do it, something. And I found the only way to, when he behaved like that, was to be a parent and to be stern with him and tell him, you know, you've got to man up here. And as you all know, he was acquitted. My mustache was saved. And, you know, he was, after the verdict, I never saw him again. He went to the Persian Gulf for a time and became more reclusive and more suspicious. He was lured out of retirement, mainly because he owed so much money, like Elvis. You know, people who have estates that approach $1 billion today were basically broke, you know, in the last years of their lives, Elvis and Michael. So he was lured out of retirement by the AEG group, now being sued for wrongful death by his mom and his siblings and the estate. And signed to do 50 concerts. They would have been lucky if they got 50 minutes worth of a concert out of him. He was so frail. When I was with him, I'm 5'9 plus. Michael is at least as tall as I am. I'm 160. Michael could not have been more than 120, 125. And his skin and his arms were so skinny, he was almost translucent. You could see when you see people that have the blue veins showing through. And and by that time, he had become totally addicted to prescription drugs. And I believe that that killed him. I believe that there is an aspect of wrongful death in what happened to Michael Jackson.